Hello everyone, this is Marina Francis from 4MCOM and this is Kavya Kashish from 2MCOM Christ Deemed to be University. We welcome you to the interview series on the theme Eco-Entrepreneurship, a part of Samshodhan National Level Research Seminar. Did you know that the traditional chewing gum we use is made from synthetic plastics and can take hundreds of years to degrade? Chewing gum is something we all use quite often, but we might not realize its environmental impact. Well, our guest today has set out to change that narrative. It is an honor to introduce to you Mr. Mayank B. Nagori, the founder of Good Gum, India's first plastic-free and 100% natural chewing gum. With his knowledge in food science and his interest in fighting plastic waste, he innovated Good Gum with natural and biodegradable ingredients. With the motivation to replace the bad gum with good gum, he approached Shark Tank India, where he was able to impress the sharks and win a deal. Apart from environmental benefits, good gum is also very beneficial for health, as it is sugar-free, which makes it a perfect substitute for candies for people with diabetes. It is suitable for people of all undoubtedly a perfect example for an eco-entrepreneur. Sir, it is an absolute pleasure to have you with us today. Welcome to the Samshodhan interview series.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Yes, sir. So firstly, can we start by telling us what was your inspiration to start Good Gum, or how was this entire idea of biodegradable chewing gum, how was this idea born?
So when I was in school, I used to chew a lot of gum because a lot of people used to say that if you chew gum while studying and you chew the same flavored gum while writing an exam, you tend to remember better. And that's exactly what we were doing. And that's when a geography teacher first told us that, you know, chewing gums are made of plastic. And this sort of plastic probably takes longer than regular plastics to biodegrade or decompose in the surroundings, right? And back in 2010, that was a question of, you know, essential versus non-essential. So, you know, chewing gum was not an essential product, but a plastic straw or a plastic carry bag was. And that's why I took a step back and stopped chewing gum for a good 7 years until 2017, when I was doing my master's in the UK. Is when I stumbled upon research which showed that, you know, the original chewing gum that the tribal people in the Amazonian forest chew have been plastic free and biodegradable for centuries together. But because of the Industrial Revolution, people moved to a plastic and a more artificial sort of a product. And that's why, you know, like I thought maybe it'll be a great thing to start this here, because people want to move to a sustainable lifestyle, but they don't really bother to, because it is first difficult and second expensive to move into a sustainable lifestyle. So we thought with the chewing gum, not just sell a product, but also sell the idea of becoming sustainable as a human being. And it can start as small as moving to a plastic-free chewing gum and then create a community around which can, you know, also look to consume materials in a more eco-friendly and a conscious manner. And that's particularly why we started chewing gum. And moreover, because of my food background, I've done sales in different companies. I realized that confectionery or the chewing gum industry is something that has not been disrupted so far. There are not many competitors in that space, and that would make it easier for us to penetrate in the market.
So we are aware about your interest in food science. Can you tell us how you started off your journey and how you structured your business out of your interest?
So after my master's in food science, I worked with a couple of startups. One of the startups was India's first women healthcare oriented brand called AndMe. We were making beverages, chocolates, tea, etc., particularly for lifestyle issues that women go through. So products for PMS, products for PCOS, etc. So initially I helped them develop new products, then moved on to a bit of manufacturing, contract manufacturing, operations, etc. And in the last 3 months of my stint with AndMe, I was running sales. So I used to handle all the modern trade operations like Godrej Nature's Basket, you know, Food Hall, these larger supermarkets, placement and distribution was taken care of by me. And that's when I kind of realized that beverages and snacks, there's a lot of people making new products, and the supermarkets don't really have so much space to keep every new product that comes into the market. Whereas a chewing gum is a category that does not really have any competition at all. And automatically it is going to be placed at the impulse purchase category. So yes, after that company, I consulted for a few brands. I helped them upscale their kitchen scale recipe to a full-fledged food product. And in the lockdown is when myself and my younger brother, who's also a Christ alumni, came about this idea that, you know, he wanted also to do something in the sustainability space, and he has a keen eye for design and packaging. So he develops every design aspect of the product while I develop the product, and everything is in-house and complementary.
So actually, in fact, when I was researching about Good Gum, that is when I was first, I got to know that chewing gum is actually made of plastic. So not many people are aware of this. So can you actually tell us what would be the harmful impacts of the regular chewing gums on the environment, and how is Good Gum different from them?
So regular chewing gums, because of their plastic nature, when people spit it out, it will, you know, it's a big public litter problem. It is the second most common form of litter after cigarettes. Once people spit it out, it will be stuck onto the roads or the footpath for hundreds of years. And when vehicles run over it, when people walk over it, all of this plastic fragments into microplastics. And this microplastics enters the water system, water table, air. And that's when you see, you know, there's a lot of reports which show that microplastics found inside the lungs of a human being, inside the placenta, inside the blood. And there are multiple possible ways in which these microplastics are entering our system. On a weekly basis, an average human being consumes one credit card worth of plastic. So there's a lot of invisible ways, but chewing gum is definitely a visible way. You're putting a piece of plastic in your mouth and expecting for it not to, you know, for a small piece of it not to end up in your system. And also in the surroundings, you know, the government, the municipalities have to spend a lot of money to clean up these chewing gums because of its sticky nature. Whereas our chewing gums are biodegradable. You know, it becomes food for the plants, bacteria, fungus in the soil feeds onto it, and you know, it just becomes one with nature.
So the chewing gum market is already having a lot of players. Like the classic brands are very much popular in between the children. They like to consume chewing gum. They already know about the chewing gum, and they're also available at a very lower price comparative to Good Gum. So how are you creating awareness about Good Gum among people? And how are you telling this that despite being a higher price range, it's better to consume Good Gum?
So you see, the Indian market is pivoting. People want to buy better for you products. People don't, you know, people initially used to look at price first and quality second, but now people are looking to, you know, buy a quality product, even if it comes at a better price. So what we are doing is we are taking a top-down approach. We are distributing our products in areas, in cities where we know our target customer is. And our target customer right now is the educated metropolitan city dweller who has a disposable income to, you know, buy a more expensive quality product. And we are not looking to sell in the smaller cities or towns where purchase is very linked on the price of the product itself. So we're taking that top-down approach and educating people through offline events, through online marketing. You know, Shark Tank has given us a lot of marketing boost as well. So, you know, like whenever we talk to people across offline stores, we realize that, you know, people don't know that chewing gums are made of plastic. But once they get to know regular chewing gums are made of plastic, they are willing to, you know, buy Good Gum. They're willing to make a conscious choice, because without education or without knowledge or without the knowledge of a choice, people will not know. So we're educating consumers first, and then automatically they become our consumers.
Okay. So actually, after hearing about Good Gum, even we would like to know, how can we purchase Good Gum? That is one question that came up to my mind suddenly.
So you can buy it on our website, we're on Amazon, a few other marketplaces. We're in about 120 odd stores across the country. You can find a list of those stores in our Instagram as well. But right now, because of the Shark Tank excessive orders. We are taking only pre-orders now, and we'll be fulfilling only 10 to 12 days after the order is placed. So I mean, those are the different ways you can buy the gums.
Okay. So in the start of your journey, what were the challenges that you majorly faced, and how did you overcome such challenges?
Challenges have always been, you know, the customers or even the stakeholders thinking that the product is expensive. People think that chewing gum is a very small category. You can't really make a big business out of it. You know, you can't really disrupt anything through a small chewing gum category. That's one problem. Secondly, because we use only natural ingredients, people always end up comparing our taste and our flavor to the artificially flavored and colored chewing gums. And it is, you know, close to impossible to be able to, you know, get the same sort of taste and texture as the artificially sweetened and colored gums. So educating consumers that, you know, the flavor not lasting very long is natural. The texture not being as soft as the regular chewing gums is natural. Those are a few different aspects that were like, you know, like some sort of bottlenecks for us. But I think with education, people have understood and they are willing to, you know, we have a good repeat rate. And that shows that, you know, people are willing to make a conscious choice. So with every industry, you will see that, you know, earlier we used to only drink a Tropicana or a fruity sort of juice. But now, despite the cold pressed juices not being as sweet and tasty, people are willing to buy a more expensive, more premium orange juice because they know it is better for them. So the trends will change and it will get better.
So being a new player in the market, and as you mentioned that you are grabbing a lot of attention in the recent times after Shark Tank, what are the future and new innovative steps that you are planning to incorporate in Good Gum? And what is your long-term vision regarding the Good Gum?
Like right now, we're focusing on being able to just fulfill all the orders that we have in hand because we did not anticipate this. We are a very small team. And until now, our issue was that, you know, manufacturing was an issue. We were manufacturing in-house. But like with this sort of volume, we are facing huge technical difficulties to be able to fulfill the orders in time. So we are looking to upscale our manufacturing so that we can control quality and manufacture in our own facility. And also, as I mentioned on the Shark Tank, that we want to, you know, start making functional chewing gums, wherein we are able to sell a more expensive product, not an expensive product, but a functional product at a larger price point. And consumers will not, you know, hesitate to buy that because people do care for their health. And when we say it comes with an added health benefit, people are willing to make a change, right? So we're looking to launch these functional chewing gums and also mainly just focus on increasing production because like with the Shark Tank's sort of publicity, we're going to be quite busy. And what we want to do as a brand is establish ourselves as a chewing gum brand. And for anybody who's growing up now, whoever is in the age group of 4 to 8, when they grow up into, you know, adults of 20 to 22, like for us, how chewing gums resonate with Boomer, we want that age group to, you know, Good Gum to be synonymous with chewing gum. And that's the sort of marketing we want to do.
Okay, so what are the kind of health benefits that you are trying to promote through Good Gums?
So chewing gums as a lifestyle addition is really good for your teeth. It helps you maintain a good jawline. It helps you suppress your cravings. There's a lot of people who want to eat something sweet after their meal. And by consuming a chewing gum, they can suppress their sweet cravings and also give a good workout to their jaws. Moreover, regular chewing gums have xylitol. Our chewing gums have xylitol, which are very good for your teeth. It helps in filling up the cavities and also preventing any new cavities from happening. So it kills all the bad bacteria that is in your mouth, which cause cavity, and only lets the good bacteria propagate. So all in all, if you're chewing gum after every meal of yours, you will never get cavities, you'll never have any plaque in your mouth, and you'll also have a great jawline.
Okay, so when I was going through your website, I came across few flavors. Can you tell our viewers what are the interesting flavors available for Good Gum? And also, I think there's a paper to spit off the chewing gum within the package.
Yeah. Yes. So initially, we started off with raspberry, strawberry, lemon, and charcoal mint. But now, 2 months ago, we also launched a spice range, which is cinnamon, clove, ginger, cardamom, and fennel. So these are Indian spices, spice-oriented flavors. We use whole spices in the gum itself. And with improvisation, we figured that we always look for a piece of paper to discard the gums. So we started using, you know, scrap paper from our printer. The printer who prints our box, he gives us, you know, trimmings of his paper that is left at his factory, and we are able to use that for, you know, a better USP for the gums as well.
So as you would be aware, this entire Samshodhan National Seminar, we are is surrounded around the theme eco-entrepreneurship. So what are your views on eco-entrepreneurship, and do you really think that it is the need of the hour?
It is definitely the need of the hour. I really insist there have to be more number of youth looking to do better for you and better for the planet sort of products, and not just look for a high paying job, because if you know, with a high paying job you'll just get money, but where will you spend that money if you don't have a good environment around us, right? So there has to be a good balance, and there have to be like a number of different startups that, you know, in the ecosystem that help consumers get a better choice and take a better, you know, like if I was not in the chewing gum space, people would still be chewing plastic, right? So there have to be more and more such brands helping consumers make better choices, because like sustainability is not 100 people doing it perfectly, but 1 million people doing it imperfectly. So you know, there can be a straw brand which you know promotes people to, you know, stop using plastic straws. Somebody would find that shift to be easier. Some people would find chewing a plastic free chewing gum easier. Some people would find carrying a plastic a cotton cloth bag for shopping easier. So there have to be multiple different companies facilitating the movement towards sustainability. So I think definitely is the need of the hour. It is a little slow initially, but I think it's very, very validating when you see consumers, happy consumers, or, you know, it helps you sleep better at night.
So I do have a younger brother. For him, chewing gum is like any other candy, which is sweet generally. And the new flavors you have launched are the spice ones. Do you think that can be something challenging for that particular segment of your chewing gum?
Yeah, absolutely. It is challenging. I am not going to sell my clove flavored chewing gum to your younger brother, or even, you know, any kid in my family. So we had the four nice tasting flavors like raspberry, strawberry for the younger generation. But like you understand, as you grow up, your taste buds mature, you start understanding spice flavors. And we started with a trial of a cinnamon chewing gum. It did really well. And that's when we launched these five new spice flavors, and people have been loving it. It's obviously the older population, anybody above the age of 30, chewing these gums as a mouth freshener.
So listening to you, as you narrated us through your journey and the ups and downs you faced, was very motivating. What is your message to our viewers and also to aspiring entrepreneurs?
My message is, if you just do everything honestly, whatever you're doing, even if you're doing, a job at a corporate, do that honestly, or, you know, like with honesty, the things that come our way are always going to be great. We never started Good Gum with the whole idea of just making money, but we really wanted to create an impact, that this is the number of plastic chewing gum that we can prevent from coming into the environment by replacing it with our gums, and also preventing people from chewing onto plastic. So that impact, honestly working towards that impact, helped us create a business. And I think it is always good on the longer run. And we are strong believers of making products that we will consume ourselves, right? Even if it's a very sugary beverage that I could launch, I can launch a Coke tomorrow, because it's not difficult to make a soft drink or a fried product. But if that is going to cause a harm to the consumers of it, I wouldn't want to do it, right? So if you're strong to your ethics and if you're honest with your approach, I think everything will fall in place. So that's the message that I'd like to give to everybody who's looking to pick up entrepreneurship. That just pursue whatever you're doing honestly and look at the longer picture.
Thank you very much, sir. As this interview comes to an end, on behalf of Christ Team 2EVA University, we would like to thank Mr. Mayank B. Narogi for joining us today for the Samshodhan interview series. It was indeed a pleasure interacting with you, sir.
Likewise.
Thank you so much. for sharing your inspiring journey. And also, we are really inspired by your commitment to sustainability. We definitely hope that this inspires our viewers to choose sustainability over just convenience and definitely pave the way for a healthier world for our future generations. So on that note, this is Marina Francis.
And this is Kavya Kashish signing off from the Samshodhan interview series. Thank you.
Thank you.